and allow to propose the motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It has been more than 3 years since human rights groups confirmed the Syrian government's use of cluster bombs in an attack which killed innocent lives, many of whom were children. So far, 220,000 people have died and 4 million have been displaced. But it took the image of one dead child lying on the shores which his parents hoped would offer them safety to remind us of our common humanity and the need for action. There seems to be some confusion regarding whether a person is a refugee or an immigrant. Economic migrants are different to refugees fleeing conflict, and we must not conflate the two terms. We cannot let the politics of immigration stop us from helping those fleeing violence and persecution. Mr. Speaker, we are currently experiencing great political uncertainty at a time when we find it hard to agree on many things. This motion is surely something on which we can all unite. The compassion of Northern Irish people never ceases to amaze me. We have seen rallies, appeals, petitions, and people even offering to open up their homes to those in need. In a radio interview 3 weeks ago, I mentioned that the Alliance Party offices were taking collections for refugees in Calais. To be honest, for a few days, it was difficult to move between desks in our premises with all the donations received. This is the best of Northern Ireland, and I would like to pay tribute to our generous people. Their response has been truly heartwarming. The UK government has undoubtedly been generous in aid terms. 0.7% of our GDP is rightly spent on international development. But we are here today to discuss the adequacy of the overall approach. Since 2011, the UK has granted humanitarian protection to almost 5,000 Syrians through normal asylum procedures. The Prime Minister recently announced that the UK would accept 20,000 Syrian refugees over 5 years, but 4,000 refugees a year is not enough. If Northern Ireland only takes 3% of that pro rata, that's 120 refugees per year. When you compare these refugees to the 800,000 welcomed into Germany or the 24,000 in France, it's clear we could be doing more. Even Brazil, halfway across the world, has taken in 2,000 Syrian refugees. The crisis is now. We do not know what the situation will be in a few years' time. We should be doing all we can now. I welcome the Deputy Minister's proposal that Northern Ireland could accommodate 2,000 refugees. The public will is there. They want us to help. Mr. Speaker, we have a moral responsibility to help refugees, and Britain has a proud history of doing just that. At the end of the Vietnam War, Britain took in 19,000 Vietnamese, the so-called boat people, who were fleeing violence and persecution. In fact, I myself volunteered with the Red Cross then to help the Vietnamese families settle in Craigavon, people who not only integrated extremely well, but were entrepreneurial in setting up businesses and seeking employment. The Syrian refugees have much to offer our society. There are doctors, engineers, and other professionals in those refugee camps who are seeking a better life. Let them seek it here. However, good sentiments are not enough. We need a plan to ensure provisions are in place for us to welcome the refugees. This is OFM-DFM's responsibility, and I understand that the department is looking at various ways in which to help play our part and work with the Home Office and other departments. In terms of action, the Refugee Asylum Forum have produced a 5-point list of necessary measures to ensure the smooth process of integration for newly arrived refugees. The first is the call for refugee integration strategy. We are the only region in the UK currently without one, which is particularly pertinent given that integration continues to be something of a difficulty in our society. The Strategic Migration Partnership produced a paper in 2013 outlining what this strategy would look like. A key point was that actions taken by departments and agencies cannot be done in isolation. For meaningful integration of refugees, the approach must be collaborative. I would like clarification from OFM-DFM regarding whether they seek to introduce a refugee integration strategy and what interim measures they are planning to take to facilitate integration in the absence of the strategy.
Would the member give way?
Yes.
Member for giving way. The member be aware on the 9th of September, as Deputy Chair of the OFM-DFM Committee, I requested that officials seek an update from OFM-DFM with regards to the contact they've had with the Home Office and indeed on the refugee integration strategy. Would she agree that the people of Northern Ireland deserve a more fuller and formal statement from OFM-DFM with regards to these particular matters as a matter of urgency?
Absolutely, I totally agree with that. Thank the member for mentioning that. The Refugee Asylum Forum also calls for a long-term commitment to welcoming refugees, which is important. Our support should last beyond the news cycle, as well as the provision of free English classes and housing. The final request is that the executive work with our excellent support sector, some of whom I'm delighted are with us here today in our public gallery. These organisations are already on the ground supporting refugees and asylum seekers, and their expertise will be valuable. One cause for concern is that the OFM-DFM's track record in delivering is not always the best. Over the years, a number of organisations and churches have had to step in and provide support to refugees and asylum seekers in the absence of government support. For example, when OFM-DFM announced the introduction of the Crisis Fund to help the most vulnerable in 2014, it took a year until it was actually put in place. A small amount of money can make an enormous difference to these people, particularly to destitute asylum seekers who are often left in limbo with very few options and have difficulty accessing services. It is paramount that we ensure our services are prepared for the refugees we will be welcoming. I would ask that OFM-DFM ensure that generous offers made by the public can be turned into practical assistance, and I look forward to hearing in the near future from the Department on the progress made in coordinating our efforts. The scale of this problem is huge, and there are no quick solutions. What is clear, however, is that there is a very great need for a coordinated European response. This is not just about taking in refugees. It is also about dealing with the root causes in conflict areas and tackling the criminal gangs preying on vulnerable refugees. As members will be aware, I have a particular interest in ending modern slavery and the unspeakable horrors refugees face at the hands of traffickers must be dealt with. I welcome the Home Secretary's recent joint declaration with France for new law enforcement collaboration and intelligence sharing. One of the most harrowing stories to emerge is of the 52 people who died in an airless hull of a boat. Those who survived this journey only did so because they could afford to pay to come up on deck to breathe. We cannot allow this to happen again. We must work together. Mr. Speaker, no one chooses to be a refugee, a person who risks everything, even life itself, in search of a tolerable existence, is a person we must help. I urge you to support the motion.
Thank you.